Hi, I'm Lady Genevieve, and the time has finally come to talk about Bridgerton Season 2. The embargo has lifted, and much to my shock, I have a lot of things to say. I have watched and rewatched these screeners multiple times now, and I can honestly say I have never in my life yelled at a ship like this. As you will have probably guessed by the title of this video, this upload is going to be focusing on reviewing and discussing Kate and Anthony as characters, and in particular, their relationship. If you would like to hear my thoughts about the other characters and subplots of season two, I will be doing more videos specifically honing in on those things. So make sure that you subscribe so you don't miss any of the several uploads I will be posting about Bridgerton season two. Before I get into the specifics, it's important for me to give you the full context of where I was at when watching this season so you can have a more complete picture of how it was that I responded to watching the material for the first time. I had not watched season one until I was given screeners for season two. I had always intended to watch it. It was on my to watch list, but I just hadn't gotten around to it yet. There's a lot of things to watch. I thought season one was fine, but really it was mostly Regé-Jean Page that was the selling point of my viewing experience for season one. I had not read any of the books or looked up any plot spoilers for what might be taking place in season two. I had not looked at any of the promo or the trailers or any clips. So I went into watching season two with a completely blank slate. I did not know that Anthony and Kate were the it couple that the Bridgerton fandom had been hungry for since season one. That is why I was completely caught off guard by Anthony and Kate meeting for the first time. It happens about 15 minutes into episode one, and their chemistry was so fire that I was immediately hooked. I was invested. I was shocked that I was getting as hyped as I was about the journey these two were clearly about to go on. Don't get me wrong, I love a good romance, but typically the ships I have found myself drawn to over the last, I don't know how many years, have been ones that exist in genres outside of straight up romance. Sci-fi, fantasy, drama, action, or perhaps an amalgamation of those other genres. Me shipping a ship in the romance genre and shipping it to this degree, it has to be powerful. And Kate Sharma and Anthony Bridgerton most definitely meet that criteria. The fact that they meet for the first time and it's just banter and chemistry, I was instantly sold on them. It was not just about having a decent story, but it's also about casting the right actors to bring these characters to life and to have that spark with each other as performers. And believe me, Jonathan Bailey and Simone Ashley put me through it with these episodes. If you're in the show's fandom, I'm assuming you have already seen that one clip of them having a bit of an encounter at a party. Well, that is the second time that they are meeting one another, and it made me want to scream when he sees her again, and he can't stop himself from smiling. He's so pleased about seeing her again. Speaking of smiling, this is maybe a mild spoiler, maybe not, I'm not sure. When he meets her for the first time, he already starts smiling. And when that happened, I was shocked. I went, oh, Anthony Bridgerton is capable of smiling now? Did he smile in the first season? I don't remember him doing all that much of that in season one. But apparently, all that was needed was for you to meet the love of your life, and now you're all smiles. Anthony Bridgerton is about to change his name to Smiles McGee with how much he lights up upon meeting Kate Sharma. Also, jumping back to their second encounter at the party, which is an exchange I feel more comfortable speaking about since the clip has already been released to the masses, so I cannot get in trouble for spoiling anything. Do you all remember at the end of that clip how stunned and befuddled his expression is when she walks off after reading him to filth? The only way I can explain what that look on his face really is the face of a man who just discovered a new kink.
That shit got me so hot! Shit got me so fucking hot!
This is a man who is no stranger to promiscuity and hedonism, but he's used to being the big ladies' man. Never in his life has he had a woman he's attracted to completely steamroll him like that. He would have no way of knowing that he's even into that, but he most definitely is when it's coming from Kate Sharma. Oop! Now we can talk a bit about each of these two characters as individuals, and then we will circle back around to talking about them as a couple. First, we will begin with Anthony. I now know that a lot of people in the Bridgerton fandom have been anticipating seeing this couple brought into the spotlight on the show, but in addition to his scenes with Kate being incredibly fun to watch, I really loved the scenes that he has with other characters. There are some really nice scenes that he has with Daphne, but also I really, really loved the recurring scenes he has throughout the season with his mother. There is some fantastic material in there that is a crucial part of developing Anthony as a character and unpacking his layers and giving him more dimension than he had in season one. If you are familiar with the source material for this season, which again, I was not when I watched the season for the first time, but I've now gone and read the book just to have that extra perspective of how it compares to the adaptation. If you've read that book, you will already know certain details about Anthony's backstory. When they introduced that backstory material into the show, you might judge me for this, but I have to be honest, I laughed because I was so startled by the information. I felt like it had been dropped abruptly onto my lap. And because I was startled, I laughed. And then I was laughing even more because I knew I shouldn't be laughing at what was happening. It was a mess.
I'm sorry. That's not funny. That's how I'm laughing.
If I had known I was going to be reacting as much as I did when watching this season for the first time, I might have considered filming my reactions and editing them into reaction videos, but I just didn't know that this season was going to attack me the way that it did. I certainly didn't mind the backstory though, because once it all plays out and you see that there's a reason for that material to be in there and how it relates to the present within the show's timeline, it all made sense, naturally. I just didn't know that that's what was going to come from it. Jonathan Bailey, he is so unreal in this season. I will elaborate more on this in a later section of this video, but I really need to stress to all of you how incredible he is as a romantic lead. If he's not already getting hit on constantly by men, women, just people of all gender identities, he most definitely will be after this. He is so powerful in this season that there are a whole lot of people who are going to be screaming their heads off, just like they did for Reggae Jean Page when he did his SNL monologue. I don't watch that show, by the way. I just saw that monologue floating around.
People may associate me with being this smoldering, sensual smoke show.
And I feel as though the importance of Jonathan Bailey being absolute fire as Anthony Bridgerton in this season needs to be emphasized. Now, normally this isn't the type of thing I would even bring up because the notion of acting like a gay man wouldn't be able to play a straight leading man is a terrible, antiquated stereotype and an act of prejudice that feels too absurd to even waste my breath on. But I found an article of Jonathan being interviewed for Glamour, and he was talking about how earlier in his acting career, he was discouraged from being out within the industry. I've heard some actors speak about this before, and it's always been absurd to me to act like gay men can't be heartthrobs to straight women. Explain Tab Hunter then. Ooh, I love Tab Hunter. He was so good in Grease too.
Now, what is the best time of the month for a woman to conceive?
Really, all of Debbie Reynolds' showman's boyfriends back in the day were closeted actors, and she was more than happy to beard for them because she was an ally. The point is that Jonathan Bailey is so powerful, so life-changing, so breathtaking as Anthony Bridgerton in this season that I feel very strongly that from now on, once this season is released to the masses, anytime anyone in the industry finds themselves in a meeting and has to deal with some gatekeeping, bigoted executive who is trying to sway the casting process away from letting a gay actor be hired to play a romantic lead in a straight romance, the non-bigoted people who have to stick up for that casting will be able to pull up Jonathan Bailey as Anthony Bridgerton to prove that that homophobic argument has no weight, no merit, and no validity whatsoever.
Are you hurt?
Come now, it is not proper to stare.
By the way, I've seen Jonathan Bailey act long before Bridgerton was ever a thing on Netflix. If you have not noticed, I'm currently wearing my American Psycho musical shirt from the original London show, and he was in that cast. I saw that show twice, and Jonathan, he did what he had to do in that show. I figured I would dig my shirt out to be festive for the occasion. I can definitely say that I prefer Anthony in the show over how he is in the book, with all due respect to the book fans, the book is very obviously a product of its time. Me personally, I don't like how common it is for romance stories that are adapted from romance novels end up having men acting like toxic cavemen. The Viscount Who Loved Me is not a prime example of that. There are far more damning examples of that toxic caveman tendency, like 365 Days, 50 Shades of Grey, and the After series. But Anthony still had a couple of moments like that in the book, whether it was his actions or his words or his thoughts. That type of behavior simply isn't appealing to me as a reader or as a viewer if it ends up being adapted on screen. Anthony is still intense in the show and he's very interested in Kate, but the writers were very good at making sure that they kept his material away from that toxic caveman territory without losing any of the passion or the intensity of that romantic relationship and the attraction that these two people have for each other. Now let's talk about Kate. I love her so much. I know there has been a lot of hype over Simone Ashley being a trailblazer by being the romantic lead of a big Hollywood project as a South Asian woman who does not conform to colorist beauty standards, but beyond just that, this character is so well written in the show. She's so compelling, and Simone is so much more than a stunningly beautiful woman, which obviously she is, everyone can see that, but she does a fantastic job playing so many different dimensions and facets of Kate as a character. The Sharma family are supposed to have spent a considerable amount of time in India before coming back to England to find Edwina a husband, and what's really cool about the way Simone performs lines is that even though she is speaking in a British accent, you will occasionally catch these very light touches in the accent that make her character sound like someone who has spent a considerable portion of their life living in India. It's very subtle, like I said, but I really like that attention to detail. There was at least one instance I can think of off the top of my head where I noticed it a little bit more, but I won't elaborate on what's happening in that scene because it's a big one.
That's suspicious.
I'm sure anyone with sense is in agreement that one of the main points of feedback for Bridgerton season one that was negative was that conversation which was thrown in that was claiming that interracial dating in the monarchy would be the cure-all for systemic racism. I've spent so much time over the last almost 2 years now being anxious or scared to go outside and end up in the wrong places because I'm visibly East Asian. And at no point during all of that fear and anxiety did I think to myself, well, at least some people date interracially. That'll help me out of a potentially dangerous and violent situation should it arise.
Punch yourself in the face.
I would have to speculate that the people in charge of Bridgerton heard those criticisms loud and clear, because I really got the impression that they backed off a lot from trying to address systemic racism. This is not the show for that. We are here for romance, smoldering eye contact, and hand stuff, which we will get to in this video. Bridgerton season two definitely seems to have learned from its mistakes of season one. The absolute last thing you should be doing is a clumsy attempt at addressing systemic racism in a romance between a British man and an Indian woman. Let's not unpack all the historical war crimes England has committed against India, or we will be here for at least 6 hours. While there are certain cultural touches in Bridgerton season two that are really nice to have, this season is better at knowing to stay in its lane in regards to those specific socio-political issues. This is a show for escapism. You have the occasional slightly altered accent, some of the designs in the Sharma family costumes, there's the Haldi ceremony, which I don't know a lot about, so I can't really give much in the way of details about that. There are also some words that they use when speaking to each other that I would guess that they're Hindi, but I'm not entirely sure. I'm very unfamiliar with the language. I'm assuming once the show comes out that that demographic of viewers will be able to specify what language they're sprinkling into the show's dialogue. I think the words are things like Didi and Abba, but I don't know if I'm even pronouncing them correctly, so take what I say about that with a grain of salt. The other big critique Bridgerton season one received was to do with that plotline of Daphne forcing Simon to do you know what, you know where. I definitely feel like this season is much more in tuned to not falling into those toxic aggressive things. Kate wants Anthony, Anthony wants Kate, but at no point are we subjected to something gross between them like what happened in season one. Kate is such a loving sister, and really, if I had any notes to offer to critique the Kate material, or by extension, the Sharma family material, it would simply be that it was so great and I would have loved to see even more of it. I don't know if this is a huge spoiler to say, but we never see any flashback scenes for Kate where we could have, let's say, seen her father, and I don't know, I think that would have been nice to further fill things out for her backstory. You do get a lot of that information through dialogue within that family unit, but I also really would have loved to be able to see it play out on the screen. Maybe the budget didn't allow for it, maybe it didn't make the cut when brainstorming because there are so many different plots happening in the season, and presumably not enough time to include every great idea that you have. I would also assume it would cost a lot of money to fly all the way to India to do a couple of scenes there, especially given the health and safety concerns that have had a financial impact on film and television productions over the last couple of years. But I don't know, what about building a set in a studio? I mean, this is obviously more so me nitpicking than anything. Overall, there is no question, I love all of the Kate material, not only with Anthony, but with her sister Edwina and her mother Mary.
She's incredible. She's a beautiful person. Her talent and brilliance is beyond. She surprises me all the time.
One of the downsides of a lot of romance films, whether dramatic or comedic, is that since they're only 2 hours, you usually don't get to give as much development to flesh out the world and the relationships of the two main characters in a romantic relationship with people outside of that core relationship. And I really love how Kate and Anthony's stories have certain parallels with each other, and you get to see both of them having these meaningful conversations with members of their families, and in particular, conversations with their mothers. This next section is something I debated making into its own video, but I'm just going to include it here instead, since it's predominantly focused on these two characters anyway. I think one of the many reasons why I had so much fun watching Bridgerton season 2 was that there were so many things in the material that ended up reminding me of other movies and love stories that I'm a huge fan of, so I'm going to share some examples of those. It's probably also useful if you are new to my channel to get a broader portrait of some of the other movies that I really love. Early on, when Kate was being introduced, I was pleasantly surprised to learn that the family dynamic was something a little bit different from what we normally see. Specifically, Kate and Edwina are half-sisters and Mary is Kate's stepmother, which is so refreshing because I am tired of Hollywood's anti-stepmother propaganda. Can you come up with something else? But when they first introduce Kate and Edwina's relationship and you're able to learn how much they love each other, I immediately thought of The Wedding Date, which is one of the most underrated rom-coms of all time, argue with the wall, when Amy drunkenly tells Kat at the bar,
"You're my half-sister, but I whole love you."
It just really made me emotional because I love The Wedding Date, and now I love seeing Kate and Edwina as sisters too, and the love that they have for each other. Speaking of sisters, I also couldn't help but get some 10 Things I Hate About You vibes from this season. Of course that was going to happen. You've got the sweet younger sister that many people are interested in, Bianca or Edwina, and then there is the tough, cool, no-nonsense older sister, Kat or Kate, who's actually secretly a sweetheart, but you have to get to know her if you want to find that out. Also, men are extremely intimidated by these women, which is further reason why I love Kat Stratford and I love Kate Sharma.
His testicle retrieval operation went quite well, in case you're interested.
I still maintain that he kicked himself in the balls.
People find that intimidating, which is not my fault.
Also, just in general, both 10 Things I Hate About You and Bridgerton Season 2, in my opinion, are upgrades from their source material. The Viscount Who Loved Me was not a bad read. I could see why it's a book that has fans, but reading it after having already seen Season 2, there was just no comparison for me and what I like in a romance. I vastly preferred Kate Sharma and Anthony Bridgerton. However, The Taming of the Shrew is incredibly unpleasant to read, it's extremely sexist, and I'm not a fan. Naturally, I think people have already started to make comparisons between Bridgerton Season 2 and the works of Jane Austen. There is, of course, Sense and Sensibility. I won't elaborate on which part of those stories are in common with each other because of spoilers, but if you know, you know. Also, Pride and Prejudice is naturally a big one. Pride and Prejudice is a love story that finds its origins in a man making a terrible impression on a woman and the two of them having to learn that there's more to each other than they might have initially thought from those early impressions. Bridgerton season 2 is just like that. You did not see him say what he said to make her as angry as she was in that clip that's already floating around, but it's right before that. Bridgerton season 2 also has that scene in the trailer where Anthony falls into the lake. Obviously, one must think about how it's like 1995 all over again when Colin Firth was in the best Pride and Prejudice adaptation, the one where they just went, we're putting in more or less everything from the book, but we're also adding a little something extra, which is Colin Firth going swimming in the lake and emerging dripping wet in a white shirt. Period piece wet shirt contests. I love to see it. But also an underrated reference is What a Girl Wants, which is a banger. I will not hear any of you trying to besmirch it. When Armistead tries to hit on Daphne without her consent again, and she pushes him into the lake, oh, she is iconic.
What did you do? That.
Anthony Bridgerton would never violate a woman's consent like that, but it reminded me of that moment nonetheless. The hand stuff in this season is also reminiscent of Joe Wright's Pride and Prejudice, but I have to save the hand stuff for later in this video. I promise we will get to it. One final Pride and Prejudice reference though that I have to mention, and this is a deep cut, I know, is that they have Rupert Vansittart make an appearance in this season. His part is very small, but I immediately recognized him because he was Mr. Hurst in the 1995 Pride and Prejudice. I love that he's in this, considering how much Pride and Prejudice energy this season already has. It's just such fun.
Such fun!
If you've seen the trailer, you've seen glimpses of Anthony wrapping his arms around Kate to show her how to shoot. And that was 100% giving me Princess Diaries 2 vibes when Prince Nicholas was helping Mia learn how to do archery. Make no mistake, I have struggled but eventually did come to terms with the fact that the Princess Diaries films are in fact royalist propaganda, but I'm of the generation that I grew up watching those films, so nostalgia will not permit me to let go of them. They're just cute and they're fun, and that part, the archery scene, ooh, it put adolescent me through it back in the day. And now Kate and Anthony are provoking those same feelings all over again, and then some. Much appreciated. I didn't know how much I needed this until I binged these screeners. Finally, there is a point in this season where a character says something to another character, and I immediately thought of one of my favorite movie musicals. I don't want to give details because it feels like spoilers. I would rather all of you just watch the season, and if you want me to specify which lyric from which musical I'm tiptoeing around currently, I can try to remember to bring it up in a video after the season has been released to the masses.
She, me, her, she does.
Now, the most obnoxious section of this Anthony and Kate video. I've tried to relay a lot of information up until this point that is relatively composed, but I need to stress to you how not composed I was when watching this season. Jonathan Bailey has the loudest, most aggressive, smoldering gaze I've ever seen in my life. I was re-watching the episodes and trying to pick out which scenes in particular have him smoldering so hard that my laptop almost overheated. Seriously, Jonathan, I will have to send you an invoice if you do that one more time.
The cheek, the nerve, the gall, the audacity, and the gumption.
I think one episode that really stood out to me for Anthony Bridgerton's smoldering gaze, it's got to be episode 4. It's not even a smoldering gaze. Smoldering is not a strong enough word to describe what Jonathan Bailey is doing with his face in episode 4. This man is committing arson. The thing with these bundled up Regency period piece romances is that characters are not always able to be as direct as you would have characters be in expressing themselves in a romance story set in present day. The eye contact is even more important. Can you make me believe in the power of a couple's attraction just by having them look at each other? And the answer to that, as it applies to Kate Sharma and Anthony Bridgerton, is hell yes. I know I've repeatedly mentioned the hand stuff in this video, and I kept putting it off and putting it off again because it warrants its own discussion at length. I'm assuming if you're watching this video, you are already aware of the fact that the Joe Wright Pride and Prejudice has had a hold on romance fans for that one hand thing with Darcy helping Elizabeth into the carriage. As far as I'm concerned, after you see Bridgerton season 2, that 2005 hand scene is nothing. You've seen a fair bit of hand stuff in the promo material. They put a few things into the trailer. That is not even close to being all of the hand stuff. There is so much Kate and Anthony hand stuff, it's ridiculous. Over half of the episodes of this season have hand stuff. The thing about the hand stuff is that once it starts, you will not have a single episode without hand stuff. And you will know when they do the hand stuff for the first time. It's very memorable.
Ah, yes!
The only way Kate and Anthony's hand stuff could be more abundant is if they had reached out of the screen and literally put me into a chokehold. There is so much Kate and Anthony hand stuff that you could do a Kate and Anthony hand stuff tier video, and all of it would be S tier. If I have any advice to you about how to handle watching the Kate and Anthony hand stuff, besides keeping a paper bag and, if necessary, an inhaler close by, it's to keep a close eye out for thumb action. I think you can see a little bit of that in the trailer when they're by the lake, but there's a really good thumb movement in this one scene that I've rewatched at least 10 times by now. I'm not sure. I haven't counted. But I know that it's a lot. We can talk more about it after the season airs if you still want to come chat about it here on my channel at that point. Also, for any of you who like to make fan cams, I implore you to make a Kate and Anthony hand stuff fan cam, and please tag me in it. Actually, now that I think about it, I might not see it if you tag me if you're not already following me because of my notification settings, but that's besides the point. I will find it one way or another. The point is, Kate and Anthony is now the standard for hand stuff. If anyone wants to try to compete with them, you're gonna have to put in a lot of effort into coming anywhere close to what they do in this season. For as much hand stuff as there is, though, the main point that I have to stress about the grip that these two have on me is that one of the most accurate ways that I could describe their relationship arc in this season is emotional edging. There were so many times where I would be watching them in their scenes together and I would get so tense in my body that I would tense up like so, and I would raise my fists like this. That's right, it was a double fist. And I would just start yelling at my screen, "Kiss! Kiss!" And then they wouldn't! You think they're driving each other wild? Oh no! We, the audience, are not excluded from that. The tension is unbearable, but in a good way. It was very satisfying. They want each other so much, they can't handle it. I couldn't handle it. A lot of you will not be able to handle it. I seriously recommend that if you're interested in doing online content creation, record your reactions. I had some great reactions of me just yelling and flailing from all the emotional edging of Kate and Anthony in this season, but I have zero evidence of any of it ever happening because I didn't know I needed to be filming in the middle of the night. I can't even do that thing where I tell you, oh, it's specifically this episode, this timestamp, because they have episodes upon episodes of things that are going to provoke enormous reactions from fans. To be fair, I had the element of surprise working in my favor because I did not know the story before watching the season for the first time. But for those of you who have read the books, you might have some ideas of certain scenes that will be big moments when watching. Now that I've read the book, I will say in a very vague way that the story is doing its own thing, but the essence of the characters, the intensity, the passion of their connection, all of that is still there, so you don't have to worry in the slightest about them delivering in that department. I actually found watching the show to be far more intense than reading the book. Maybe that's because I had, like I said, the element of surprise working in my favor, but the book feels a bit more traditional in its gender roles. The man is very much the aggressor in the relationship. I think the show leans more egalitarian for their relationship dynamic. They are both completely overcome by how strong their feelings for each other are. They are both trying desperately not to act on those feelings. They are both active parties in the relationship, which I think will appeal to the modern sensibilities of the audience of the show. Besides, edging is edging no matter what century your characters are in and what gender they are. I know that the show and source material means a lot to people who were already in the fandom, but as someone who came into the viewing experience with zero expectations, good or bad, I was completely neutral going into it. I was just watching press screeners with the intent of making a review for my channel. I can now say that Kate and Anthony are now in my top tier of ships, of couples, of romances, the chemistry, the emotional edging, the hand stuff, Jonathan Bailey committing arson with his smoldering gaze, Simone Ashley having the most iconic eyebrows when she's judging this man for being a rake, a libertine, before realizing there's actually more to him than she initially thought, and that she has capital F feelings for him. All of it was an 11 out of 10. Everything else in the show pales by comparison. There are other characters and plots that are interesting or entertaining to watch, but absolutely nothing else in this show made me feel the way I felt about these two. In the book, Kate and Anthony have very specific fears that are keeping them from being able to fully live their lives and freely love each other and express that love. But in the show, it's only partially about that. It's also about two people who have a lot of emotional walls up and feel incredibly duty bound to do what's best for their families, regardless of what might make themselves as individuals happy. I found that this made both of them even more likable because no matter what, you know that they love their families and they want to take care of them. And because that's such a selfless thing to do, you want these two characters to be able to find love and happiness in their own right as well. It's also just a more interesting conflict to potentially interfere with this blossoming love connection. It also means that these two have a lot in common besides just their attitudes and sharp tongues. They have the same values of love for one's family and fulfilling the duties that will keep their families happy, healthy, and provided for. This video is already getting long, and I'm sure you are very sick of my waffling at this point, so I won't go into too much detail about certain socio-political aspects of the Bridgerton premise and setting. Perhaps that could be its own video, I don't know, it just depends on how much interest there is from the audience, but an important part of the Regency setting is that marriage and the pursuit of marriage is deeply intertwined with economic anxiety. Women in particular need to marry and marry well because the legalities of the way the society around them exists is that it's difficult or impossible for them as women to be financially secure without a husband or a trustworthy man to bear those financial responsibilities. That logistic reality further contextualizes why certain characters do or don't conduct themselves in a certain way. It's not the only thing at play, of course there are emotions and feelings involved, but I like that there is this conflict which comes from an external societal factor and not just two people being really stubborn about not kissing when they should be kissing already instead of edging the audience again and again. As a smaller note, one recommendation I would give to viewers, whether casual or avid, is to rewatch season one close to watching season two. There were a couple of parallels between season one and season two that I thought were really nice touches in the writing, and I think they're best appreciated if certain plot details are fresh in your mind from season one. Naturally, I will not be elaborating on that because spoilers. But again, if you would like to continue this discussion after the episodes are released, when I will be able to talk about everything in full detail, let me know. I would be more than happy to do it. Also, I am currently in the midst of planning a Q&A video about this season to post before the season airs. So if there is anything you want to know, leave it in the comments. I already have a few questions saved from social media, but I could use a couple more just to make sure that I have enough to say to do a complete video that's worth watching. Season two is better than season one, and it's not even close. I'm really looking forward to talking more about it in the coming days. I hope you enjoyed this video. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment if you would like to follow along with more of my opinions about Bridgerton season two. Thank you for watching. I will see you in the next video when I will be talking about the other characters and subplots of season two, since Kate and Anthony were simply too powerful to not get their own video. Bye.